take your Bibles, I will invite you to turn with me to chapter 20 of the Gospel according to John. As we're coming to close of this great study of this great Gospel, which we've been in for now for many months, we come down to, I guess you could say, John's way of describing why he wrote this Gospel. You see, we've entitled this last chapter, or next to the last chapter, as Our Lord's Victory. And we found out last Sunday that this victory was literally given and was won at the resurrection. It wasn't at the cross. It wasn't in his suffering. Victory came at the resurrection, and John said, these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. That's why I wanted to lead you through an expository study of this gospel. It's because I want everyone under the realm of my preaching and teaching to have been introduced to Jesus. That's my goal as your pastor. That's my goal as your friend. And my prayer is that you will know him and that you would have life in his name. And so, to understand that, I want to work us to work through this victory. Jesus won a victory when he came out of the grave. And he literally is offering that victory to us. When you look at this chapter and you break it down, John is writing so he might help us believe. And today we're going to talk about how we... And John is writing so that we might receive. You'll understand here in just a minute what I mean. But lastly, that we might conceive, that we might fathom. And the one that had a trouble with it was his name was Thomas. But that's next Sunday, and probably the Sunday after that, because we have the Lord's Supper next Sunday, and I hope you'll come and enjoy a wonderful day of worship. You remember last Sunday we talked about how he helped us to believe. You remember John wrote about the physical evidences of his resurrection. He told us about the physical evidences that would help us believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and that he did rise from the dead. And that we can have life. He also wrote about the presence of angels and how that John saw, as well as John heard the witness of others about the presence of angels in and around the tomb. But lastly, John wrote about a personal relationship, one his own. It was about Mary. About how Mary was changed when she finally knew Jesus. You remember the question last week is, who did you come and seek? Who are you seeking? Are you seeking a healer? Are you seeking someone that will fill your belly or your bank account? Or are you seeking a Savior? See, that's the question. And the sad part about it, most of us seek Jesus for healing, for comfort. You see, Mary found her Savior. Thomas will find his Savior. The disciples will find their Savior. Because his standard is reached. And my goal is in your life, Jesus, will be found by you. He's standing there. My question is, who are you seeking? But John tells us, and the story continues, and it really gets interesting. I love the story of that first day of the resurrection. We're still on Sunday. We haven't left it yet. We were there last Sunday. We were talking about how he rose from the dead early in the morning. And now we've made it all the way to the evening. So take your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 20, verse 19. And if you would, to please honor the reading of the Word of God, would you stand to your feet if you're physically able? And John writes, "Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, that the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' When he had said this, he showed his hands and his side, and then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, 'Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you.' And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained.'" Father, help us to understand and help us to receive this true victory. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Three things John writes. Three things that comes with victory. Number one, peace. His peace. Number two, his commission. With victory, and when victory comes, let me tell you, that commission is given. And thirdly, his gospel. His good news. Let me explain real quickly. Number one, his peace. Look what happened in verse 19. It said, "The same day at evening." Friends, it's the same day. This is the Sunday. This is the first day of the week, as John wrote. He said, "But the doors were closed, and Jesus appeared in the midst." The most amazing thing is some people said, well, he was a ghost, and he could go through walls, or he knew a different secret door or something. He just appeared, and they wasn't expecting him. No, let me tell you something. Jesus Christ stood before them in his glorified body. His glorified body could eat fish. It could drink water. It could be touched. It could be handled. But at the same time, it could pass through a brick wall or a rock door. I can't explain it, but that's exactly what the Hebrew and the Greek means, is that when he appeared, it meant no door opened, no window was open. He just came through the wall and he appeared. Let me tell you something. One day, we'll have that type of body. You see, Jesus appeared. I don't know about you, but it would cause an uproar if Jesus would come through the wall behind Madge over here, where there is no door. And Jesus would walk through that wall, and we would see him, and we would be able to touch him. You think you would be peaceful? You think you would be at rest? No. You'd be scared to death. I know I would. Why do you think Jesus said, "You need my peace"? But as he showed up on the scene, as he came in their presence, that peace began to settle in. Because you know, what did he do? What did he do when he walked through the wall? He didn't go up and hug them. He didn't go, "Hey, we won." No, he said, "Look, that's what the Bible said." The Bible said Jesus held out his hands. The Bible said, John said, he showed his side. You see what it says there in verse 19? And verse 20. He said, and when he had said this, he showed his hands in verse 20 and his side. And the disciples were glad they saw the Lord. What did they see? What did they see in the hands and in the side? They saw their forgiveness. Jesus could have come into that room and he could have reprimanded every one of them because they had left him. They had deserted him. They had lied. They had cheated. They had hid out like a pack of rats up there in that upper room. And let me tell you something. He had the right to fuss at them. But what did Jesus say? No, look, this is what your forgiveness cost me. This is my blood that I shed from my heart for you. And I don't know, when you finally see that Jesus, when he stands before you and he shows you his scars and he shows you his side and you finally realize that I'm the one that put him there, all I can do is fall at his feet. All I can do is find peace. Because finally I'm at peace, not with myself, not with my sisters or brothers, but with God. I'm at peace. Because I can look at those nail-scarred hands and that speared side and I can see my forgiveness, but I also can see his lordship. This man was crucified. This man was buried. This man laid in the dead in the grave for 3 days. And now he's standing before me. Friends, let me get you excited if I possibly can. We serve the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Why? Because he came back from the dead. He has conquered death, hell, and the grave. And so he gives that victory to you if you'll only receive it. Jesus. can be reminded from Katie that God so loved me. I can sing and shout, heaven came down in glory, filled my soul. I can find peace in worship. And believe me, that's what happened right there in that room, is true worship came. But listen to what he's saying. You see, I pray, my prayer is that God will help you receive his commission. Yes, I want you to have his peace, but I want you to understand and know his commission. You see, the sad part about it is we're here, as we talked about this morning, and we're worshiping our sacred cow. You said, what in the world are you taught? What did you teach in your Sunday school class, preacher? I preached that our idols most of the time are worship and church. That we have to do it the same way, in the same place, in the same seat. And when it's up, when it's interrupted, God help us is all I can say. Sitting over behind Alicia and Mark at an old place called Camp Baptist Church, used to be a pew in a seat. Mr. Ullman would come in. Everybody knew him. I'm not going to call his first name because many of you might have known him. But Mr. Ullman would come in from smoking his cigar right outside the door with the other 25 or 30 men, and he'd always come in late because he had to get one more draw off his stogie. He's hard of hearing, too. It's real hard of hearing, and so that meant he talked really, really loud. And I probably wasn't 10, 12 years old, and I was sitting way on the other side of the church. And all of us kids were sitting there, and here come Mr. Roman in the door, and we said, oh no, somebody's in his seat. This ain't going to be pretty. We almost started taking bets if he'd kick him out or what. He got pretty ugly. Mr. Roman looked at him and he said, excuse me. Excuse me! Excuse me! You're in my pew! Move! I'll never have forgotten him in almost 50 years. I can still hear that old man say, get out of my pew. It's our sacred cow. It's called an idol. And let me tell you, if you worship this place, or even me, or your Sunday school class, or whomever you are, if you worship that as dead as your sacred cow, just as bad as the Israelites was, and let me tell you, I am trying to learn to pray like Moses did. Oh God, blot out my name from your book to save my brothers. No, he called us here and he commissioned us. So hang on to your britches. Because it's really simple. And it's really plain. You might want to check up on your sacred cow and see if you have it. Because Jesus said in verse 21 again, peace to you. Simply, as the Father sent me, I also send you. You see, his commission is very simple, and that is to demonstrate. Stop and think for a minute. Why did Jesus come to this earth? Well, preacher, we know that, and I on the cross to save me from my sins. No, that wasn't the only thing. No, Jesus came to this earth so that you might know God. That you might know his holiness and his righteousness. That you might know his requirement. Just to die for your sins and send you along your merry way and let you abuse it, let you do and live the way you want to. Let me tell you something, friends. That's the farthest thing from the truth that there's ever been. God sent Jesus Christ to this earth to show you what perfection is, to show you what tell you something. Jesus Christ never steered from the truth. He faced down the sacred cows. But he also faced down the sinners of the world with love and compassion. You see, our commission is just as Jesus was sent into this world, so are we. You see, so if your worship is what you enjoy and what you truly call your relationship with Jesus Christ, you don't have one. You have a sacred cow called church or religion. John said, I want you to have life. I write these things so that you might understand. I want you to receive the commission. See, many times, and I shared with my class, God took my sacred cow away. He kicked me out of Canton Baptist Church. And let me tell you something, it hurt. It scared me. But God got me out of Canton so I would do the very next thing, and that's proclaim. It took him taking me out. You see, these men were standing all in a room along with the ladies, and Jesus shows up in the midst and he says, I want you to go out into the world as the Father sent me, so I send you. He said, go. And what I want you to do is I want you to proclaim. He said, I want you to tell them. I want you to truly go and tell them. He said, you're not going to do it alone. You see, Isaiah said it this way, and Jesus also repeated it. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. Oh, preacher, I thought that was just for preachers. No, that's for every Christian or born-again believer. This is not the preacher. This is not the staff of the church. This is you. Even though I send you, Jesus said. He said he has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to opening of the prisons to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God. Did you hear what Isaiah said? Oh, I'm going to preach forgiveness, but I'm also going to preach the truth that God is going to avenge one day. God's going to judge, but God will forgive. That's the gospel. And the sad part about it is we only share one side. God will forgive. God will forgive. Now let me tell you something. Stand warned. You don't turn to God in this life, you will face his wrath and death. Plain and simple. That's the gospel. You say, preacher, why are you so arrogant? Well, number one, he tells me that we can do this with power. You see, Jesus did something that has confused a lot of people. In verse 22, it says that Jesus literally says, receive the Holy Spirit. What did he do? He breathed. Why didn't they get the Holy Spirit right then? Why did they have to wait 40 more days? You ever thought about it? Why did they have to wait 40 more days? What was Jesus doing? Was he teasing them? Was he lying to them? What was he doing? He was only illustrating what was about to happen. That the Father, 40 days from that day, would literally bow his head from heaven and he would breathe. And he would breathe into the souls of man. And let me tell you something, friends. It's exactly what happened to you as you got saved. If you've been born again, God breathed into your life his Spirit. You won't have to do it again. Do what, preacher? What do I have to do? What is the and receive his gospel. I'm going to go ahead and open all these up because we've got to hurry to an end because we're out of time. The gospel deals with forgiveness as well as lostness. But it also deals with authority. You see, the gospel is given to you with authority. Now, read that verse again, verse 23. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. The Roman Catholic Church bases confession on that one verse. They also base their priesthood of believers, or the priest's job in the parish of the Catholic Church, with that one verse, that the priest has been given the authority to say, okay, your sins are forgiven, my sister. Your sins have been forgiven, my brother. Or your sins have not been forgiven, my brother. Or your sins have not been forgiven, and God is going to answer it in heaven. Let me tell you, God never gave one person or one religion that type of authority, but he did give every one of you even more. Number one, you got to go back to the original Greek, and you've got to understand, and believe me, I don't read it, but I read men that do. And it tells me that literally it means that the sins that are forgiven have already been forgiven. The sins that are retained have already been retained. God's already made the decision. God's already made the transaction. So what are you getting at, preacher? Let me tell you, Christian. You can take Romans chapter 10, verse 9, and you can hold it in front of an unbeliever, and with the greatest authority, and it's not your authority, it's not anything that's been given you other than that from above, you can read to them and says, if you believe that Jesus Christ died and that he rose again, and you confess your sins, and you call upon his name, that verse says, you shall be saved. Do you realize that you have the authority to escort a soul from hell into heaven? But do you also realize that you have the authority that, friends, that if you do not accept and receive this commission, if you will not accept and receive this gospel, let me tell you, those people out there on the streets are going to go to hell, and it's going to be because of your authority, not exercise. Yes, we have that type of authority. Yes, you have the authority to look at your children and say, if you don't call upon Jesus as your Savior and get saved, you're going to pay for it in hell. You have all authority in the world. Because what God said was, it's already been done. Forgiveness has already been given. Sin's already been issued. So friends, I close today and ask you, is that the type of religion you have? Or is it to sit on the pew and talk about the preacher and the choir and the Katie's that sing and the people that can't sing? And to go out of here and back talk and gossip and tear down everything that we're trying to do? Or is your, have you received the true victory? It's a question you need to ask yourself. It's a question that only you can answer. Because let me tell you a little secret. Sitting in the pew is not worship. Singing a song is not worship alone. You know what worship is? We when you receive the good news of the gospel and you stand with all authority, and not on yours but on the word of God, and you say, thus saith the Lord. I've been reading Jeremiah for the last 2 or 3 weeks, and my heart is broken for that man. Because every time he told them the truth, they threw him in a dungeon or they threw him in a well. You see, friends, Jesus wanted us, John wanted us, to receive victory. The victory of peace. The victory of commission. And last, the victory of the gospel. You have the victory. Will you use it? Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, help us to leave here victorious. Help us to commit our lives to you. Help us to receive that victory today. And Father, help us to go from here and be a Jesus to someone out there. Help us to take this word to others. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus is calling you tenderly, softly and tenderly. Will you receive this victory? That's John's purpose for writing. That's Jesus' purpose for coming. He said, as the Father sent me, so I send you. Will you come?
Page 190, if you'll please stand and sing.
Jesus Christ, who died to make it. God bless you. I hope you have a beautiful and wonderful